Good afternoon and welcome, everyone. My name is Cameron May. It's 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time on a Tuesday afternoon. That means it's time to get back to our ongoing weekly series of discussions called Getting Started with Technical Analysis. Today's lesson 6 in a series of 8 intended lessons. And we may be addressing the number one question of just about every new investor. When do I buy and when do I sell? What might a chart user look for on a price chart to help them identify entries and exit points? So I think this is going to be a great discussion. We'll set a more precise agenda for it in just a moment. But before we do, let me first of all say hello to everybody. It's already chatting in from all around the country. Hello there, Tom, Gary, Michael, Manuel, Kim, David, Robert, Peter, everybody else. Thanks for joining us every week. We definitely appreciate your attendance and your contributions. If you're here for the very first time, I'd like to welcome you as well. If you'd like to chat in, let me know it's your first time in one of my webcast series. I do like to see who my new audience members are, if you feel comfortable disclosing that. And if you're watching on the YouTube archive after the fact, enjoy the presentation. Be aware that you're invited to join us in a live discussion. It does kick off promptly, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time on Tuesdays, and this one runs right about 45 minutes. And as a final heads up, my very good friend James Boyd is going to be hanging out in the chats. He's going to be answering any questions that I can't get to during the natural flow of the presentation. Thanks for being there, James. But everybody, let's get right into this. The very first thing that we always need to do is pause to consider the risks associated with investing and trading using charts. These disclosures are important. The information here is for general informational purposes only, should not be considered an individualized recommendation or endorsement of any particular security, chart pattern, or investment strategy. While this webcast discusses technical analysis, other approaches, including fundamental analysis, may assert very different views. All investing involves risks, including loss of principal, and options carry a high level of risk and are not suitable for all investors. All right. So with that accomplished, that set the agenda for the day. Pretty straightforward agenda. Two items that we want to make sure that we cover, but a lot contained within these two bullet points. We're going to be addressing these questions: when to buy and when to sell. All right. There's not a perfect answer for every investor out there, but we're going to be reviewing some common bullish and bearish technical signals that are used for potential entries and exits. So there's a lot to cover in just that. If we're looking for bullish and bearish entries and exits, two different types, two different stripes, it's going to be about 16 different charts we're going to be looking at today. We're going to discuss these things in theory, and then we're going to go to application, applying these principles and techniques to current example charts. So we're going to need to get right into this. Let's kick things off with a discussion of entries. When a chart looks at a chart, a price chart, what might they be looking for to signal, hey, today's the time to get bullish, or maybe even today's the time to get bearish? Well, we're going to break this down into two potential entry signals, and we're going to apply those to bullish and bearish examples. The first entry signal is commonly known as a bounce. Means that price has come down and ricocheted off of a price floor, or maybe risen up to and ricocheted off of a price ceiling, a price bounce. Now, specifically, an investor might be looking for something. If you look up here on the deck, there's an acronym here that might not be familiar to all of you. I think that most of you are going to be familiar with this, but it's the acronym CAHOLD, C-A-H-O-L-D. It stands for a close above the high of the low day. You can see that there in the third bullet point on our deck, on our slide here. But this is a signal in this example, a bullish trader who's seeing an up or a sideways trend that price may be set to continue in the direction of that trend. And this happens at a time when within that trend, price falls down to support and then begins to rise again, bounces off that support. Now the acronym, close above the high of the low day, bit of a mouthful, but it's referring specifically to the candles. And what it requires is that we're able to see, first of all, a low day. That's the first step here. What is a low day? Well, that's when price has pulled down. It's gotten close to a support level. Whichever candle sticks its little tail down the furthest, the trader might call that the quote-unquote low day. And then as prices start to rise again, what the trader is looking for here is that maybe the momentum has gone from short-term bearish to short-term back to bullish in the direction of that sideways or upward trend. And the specific confirmation here is when price closes above the highest point of that day that we've identified as the low day. Okay, that's the theory. Let's go look at it in real life, see what this might actually look like on a chart. So for our first example today, I'm going to be using Visa. Now, in this case, this happens to be an upward trending stock. We can see that we've been making higher highs and higher lows within an apparent price channel. And so within that trend, for some traders, they see conceptually better times to enter than other times. Do we want to be buying up near this price ceiling or maybe down near price floor? Well, even within an established upward trend, we're probably looking to buy in as we're relatively close to that price floor. The difficulty there is that in order for price to get down to that floor, it's going to have some bearish momentum built into it. You can see we're pulling down here. Here's another more recent example where we've pulled down to that price floor. And for some traders, rather than just buying because we're at or near what they think is a support or a price floor, they might feel uncomfortable thinking that they're essentially trying to catch a falling knife. They might want to see from a day-to-day, on a day-to-day time frame or candle-to-candle, because this can also be conceptually applied to weekly charts or to hourly charts. We're using daily charts in this series to teach most of these concepts. But with price falling, we're getting close to support. What the investor is looking for here is the candles start to confirm the assumption that we've reached a price floor and that it's likely to hold. And the specific expression of that is we get a bounce. So first step here in identifying this close above the high of the low day is to identify the low day. So as we're approaching support in this recent example, you can see this red candle. It's not always a red candle, but in this case, this red candle is the candle that stuck its little tail down the furthest as we got to what we thought might be a support level. Okay, so that becomes our low day. And if it's helpful, let me zoom in. So it's a click and drag on that time frame. I'm just going to zoom in so we're looking at that highlighted period so we can see these candles more precisely. So this candle right here, we may call this the low day. And so for some traders to identify that momentum has shifted and we've gotten back to bullish and the bounce is quote unquote confirmed, we might look for a closing price above the high of that low day, including the candle wick. So you see a little tiny wick on this one, just sticking out the top of that body. We'll call that the high. And in this case, that high was, if we point at that, we can see that was actually $231.39. So what we're looking for on a subsequent day, frequently the next day, but not always, we're looking for a closing price above the highest point of that low day. So as we look at this day, that was October 27th. There's our low day. On the 30th, so that was actually a weekend. The 27th was a Friday, 28th, 29th, Saturday, Sunday. On Monday, we got a closing price above the high of the low day. Close above the high of the low day. There's our bounce. That's all a fancy way to say that this has happened. We pulled down to support, and we're starting to bounce. And the assumption is there that we might continue higher. All right. Is that a guarantee? Of course not. None of these signals are guaranteed that they're going to generate profitable scenarios in every case, right? But that is, I think, a fair example of a recent support bullish bounce, okay? Harley's saying, it's 5 days before. Was there another low? Is that another hold? There's a good, yeah, Harley. Could a trader have seen this low? This is what Harley's referring to. And this is why just bringing up a chart and looking back in recent history, we can learn so much. Let me just clean up this chart a little bit here. Remove some of these drawings. And so Harley might have been looking at this. Hey, we've pulled down here. We didn't get quite down to support, could we make the argument that we're in the area of support? I think we might have a case there. And then, this would be our low day in that case, right? It was the lowest candle within this pullback period, getting close to support. So we might have been looking for a close above the high of this day. Look what that next candle did. Yep, that one gave a close above the high of the low day, and it worked for about a day and a half, and then we sagged back down. But that's going to set us up nicely, Harley, for the latter half of this discussion. When might we sell? Would this have been panic time? Uh-oh, we got two red candles following an entry. That means it all failed and it's broken, right? Not necessarily. Good question, though. Okay, let's just remove that drawing. But let me just bottom line this for you, Harley. Would I say that we could make that case as this being a hold, a close above the high of the low day? Yes. All right. So that's if we're in an uptrend. We could also potentially look for the same thing in a sideways trend. Some traders consider sideways trends to be perfectly tradable. So as an example of that, how about we look at AVGO? AVGO recently went through a consolidation where the highs were roughly the same, the lows were roughly the same, and bulls might still see that as quote-unquote tradable. In this case, they might be looking for price to pull back down to at or near a price floor. And I think this also illustrates, let's go to the most recent example. We pulled down from the high to the low, so we're at or near support within a sideways or upward trend, this one sideways. In this case, we had a red candle that was the lowest. Let me zoom in on that so we can see it a little bit more clearly. There it is right there. Its high was right here. The next day, we didn't close above the high of that low day. Does that mean we can't get a hold anymore? Nope. In some cases, we have to wait a few days. And here, we actually got a close above the high of the low day here. And that may have been the entry signal. Now, for some traders, depending on how they plan their exits, they may have determined, well, that's an entry signal, but it was a little bit late. Here's one of the facts of when we're using a hold entry. If we get a big, tall candle at or near support, and then we're waiting for the rally up off that low, we might have to wait sometime. And it might mean that we're some distance off that low before we finally get an entry signal. Not every entry signal is quote unquote perfect. That's one of just the realities of these sorts of things, okay? But we'll talk about planning exits. But there are a couple of examples. Are there more recent examples here? Yeah, we could go back here in time. Here we're pulling down to support. We got to the area and actually ducked below, but then rose right back up above. We're inside that channel again, close above the high of the low day there. Okay. But in any case, there's our bullish bounce entry. So now we know one type of signal that a trader might go looking for is they're looking for entries in an uptrend or a sideways trend. They might look for a different set of signals, though. We also have a set of signals known as a breakout. Now, in this case, we're not looking at the price floors for the signal, but instead the price ceilings within that up or sideways trend. So again, we're looking for up or sideways, but in this case, price rises up to the ceiling and then pushes through. And we get what's known as a breakout signal. Now, in this case, quite commonly, not every trader does this, but quite commonly, since there has previously been a reluctance to go above that high, to go above that resistance, some traders do prefer that these breakout signals be confirmed with above average volume. Okay, so let's go look at some examples of maybe bullish breakout entries. So now in this case, let me show you on your chart, if you're not seeing your volume displayed down at the bottom of the chart, and if you are among those traders, let's say we're traders that are looking for volume confirmations on breakouts, we can add that by clicking on the little gear icon up here. Go to the equities tab. The gear allows us to change our chart settings. Go to equities and show that volume subgraph. So let's apply that, click OK, and now we can see our volume right down there. All right. So for our breakout examples, how about we stick here with AVGO? So here's Broadcom. We saw that it was within this channel and maybe our bullish traders are looking to buy at these lows. Well, eventually we push up two and then look what happens right here on, was that December 10th? Yep. We finally move into new territory. Finally break through that price ceiling. And at that moment, I know it doesn't look like much, but if we zoom in here, that volume on that day was the best volume we had had in, who knows, 20 days? Was that above average volume? Yeah, that was above average volume, maybe confirming that bulls are excited to move into new territory. Maybe conceptually, they're done with this range. And so for some, when we move out of a trading range, that might be seen as a signal, especially if we're moving higher out of a trading range, that prices are set to go maybe to still higher levels. So this is known as a breakout. And this, in this case, was a sideways trend. But how about an upward trend with Visa? You might have caught this. I don't know. This is going to be interesting because here we are trading within an apparent channel, support to resistance, floor to ceiling. Look what's happened just today. Price has finally moved up and outside of that range, or it appears to have done. Now, there are going to be some traders that might take exception to this being a signal of a breakout. What might be the problem with this? Well, in this case, it doesn't look like this happened on much trading volume. And for some, they might say, I don't know, I'd like to see more, here's the interpretation, more enthusiasm on the place of buyers, on the part of buyers. If we're really ready to move into new uncharted territory, maybe the trader prefers to see a lot of supporting purchase orders, a strong imbalance between buyers and sellers on higher volume. Okay. Chyna says, do we buy or exit? Okay, good question, Chyna. We haven't talked about exits yet. All of these have been entries, right? And they're typically, in the case of bullish trades, associated with green candles. They're not always, though. It's possible that we could just get a big gap up, pushing us through resistance, a big gap up, bouncing us off support with a little fade from open to close, and it could actually create a red candle, but still be, in the eyes of some, a legitimate bounce or breakout. Just be aware that both of these signals can happen in sideways or in upward trends, okay? So let's go back to our charts. We've learned about the bullish side of things for entries. When might a bear be looking to get in? Well, and again, these are just examples. These are not the signals that every trader out there is using, but oh, and Tanya's asking, is there a small flag on V over the last number of days? A good question, Tanya. I'm not going to break off too much into a discussion of price patterns, but it's a possibility of a flag. This isn't V. This isn't Visa on our example chart here, but we might even see an example of a bull flag right there, right, Tanya? Run up, pull back, and in this case, a bounce. Yeah. Okay, well, let's talk about things through a bearish lens. And this shouldn't take us very long because we're basically looking for similar behavior, but in the opposite direction. We might be looking for bounces and breakouts. Support and resistance are going to both play a role, but the acronym changes. Now, I kind of like the acronym CAHOLD because it's easy to say. Kind of rolls off the tongue. This one sounds a little bit more forced. CABLOAD. What do you think it stands for? Yeah. A close below the low of the high day. Look for price to close below the low of the high day. So for this one, the trader is typically looking for down if they're planning a bearish trade, commonly looking for a downtrend or sideways. Okay. But in this case, the trader is looking for price rather than falling to support, rising up to resistance. When might a bearish trader be looking for entry? Well, when they think things are getting a little bit top heavy, maybe starting to head down again. So that's preceded commonly by a rise to resistance. And then we see that price begin to fall again, or in other words, bounces down from resistance. So here's an example here where price is running down. It's pulled up to resistance, bounced, and started to head down again. Now, just as with the identification of a CAHOLD entry, here we need to be able to identify a specific candle. And this is, as we're rising toward resistance, we look for the highest candle, the one that sticks its little wick up the highest. That becomes our high day. And then we're looking for a close below the low of that high day. So on our green candle example here, here's our high day. And this one with the oval around it, we close below the low of that high day. CABLOAD entry. So let's go see that one on a chart. and we'll get specific with this one. We're even going to look at the pennies regarding highs and closes. So for our bearish bounce, how about we look at RTX as a potential example of a sideways bounce? So here's a stock that's had relatively similar lows, relatively similar highs, but recently it has risen up to support, up to resistance. So let's zoom in on that time frame. There we go. So sideways trending stock, which let me let you look at this for just a moment. Knowing what you now know about the definition of a bearish bounce, which candle do you think represents the signal day? This is for bearish entry. Price is rising. Each day, we're getting higher and higher and higher. Intraday highs. This day's high is higher than that one. This day's high is higher than that one. This day's high is higher than that one. Right here, if you were looking at this as our high day, congratulations, I would agree with that. That's our example high day right there. So if we're looking for a close below the low of that high day, here's the low. And if we point at that day, we can actually look up here at the L and see the low for that day was 82.33. So we're looking for a subsequent day, the next day, the day after that, the day after that. We're looking for a subsequent low, a subsequent close below 82.33. And the very next day, we closed at 81.50. Yep. So I would consider this to be the example day of our close below the low of the high day kablode entry. Right? That's in a sideways trend, but we can also see these in downtrends. So an example of that might be Merck. Okay. Here's Merck that's been channeling downward, running down lower highs, lowered lows, pulling up to resistance, back down to a deeper support, up to resistance, down to support. And then do that same analysis for me again. Let me zoom in. If we seem to be up at resistance, let me zoom in on that. Do you feel comfortable that you might be able to identify the bounce entry within this downtrend? So here we have the run up to resistance. This day's high is higher. This day's high is higher. Higher, higher. That high is the highest. You'll notice the next day, the high is starting going lower. So this we might consider to be the high day. So looking, so in this case, for our bearish entry, we're looking for a close below the low of that high day. That looks like that's right about here. And did we close below that the next day? Yes. So there's our kablode bearish entry on a bearish bounce. All right. So that's our example for bounces. We can also see breakouts, downtrend or sideways trend. We're still looking for the same general price behaviors on a chart. But in this case, we're watching for price to fall down to and then through support, breaking out to the downside. And once again, the trader may prefer to see this accompanied by volume. Now, those of you who have been doing this for a while, how many of you have heard that maybe for bullish breakouts, volume's a little bit more emphasized? For bearish breakouts, maybe not so much. There is a phrase out there that the price can tend to quote unquote fall of its own weight. That's a fancy way of saying some traders don't care what the volume does. On the bearish breakout, as always, it comes down to personal preference anyway. But yeah, we might want to have volume on our chart as confirmation of this broken support. So let's go look at a couple of examples of broken support. All right. So how about for our sideways breakout? How about Walmart? You can see Walmart pretty much all year has had this one level that's acted previously as a pretty prominent area of resistance, a price ceiling, and then that transitioned to a new price floor right around $153. Looks like, and this was just a misquote, this big weird looking candle back here. Every once in a while, there can be a misprint that comes through the quote feed that causes a weird candle like that. But in any case, all of the trading for the first 5 or 6 months of the last 12 really seem to be below about 153. A couple of rare examples, rare exceptions right there. But then we start trading above that level. And that was a price floor until right here, about December 7th, right? Price fell down to support and then broke through. In this case, you can see volume got a little bit of a bump here. We've seen a little bit stronger volume, but not really on the breakout day. For some, they'd take exception. They'd say, doesn't qualify for me. For others, they say, you know what? We broke support. Good enough. Okay. But that's a sideways breakout. We can also see breakouts as trend is just heading downward. So an example of that might be BMY, Bristol Myers. So here's BMY that had been really trading within a range. And this range even stretched back further than my drawing. Lower highs and lower lows, support to resistance. And then right here on heavy volume, this looks like this was about October 26th. There was an acceleration of that downward trend breaking it out of that range. And for some, they may see that at a valid break as a price floor, and that may be a new bearish entry. Okay. All right. So we've looked at bounces and breakouts for bulls and for bears. That's kind of fun planning when to get into a trade, but just as important, perhaps more importantly, is when might a trader get out of a trade that they've taken. So let's talk about exits for bullish and for bearish trades. We're going to talk about fun exits. We're going to talk about the not so fun exits where we're actually going to be taking losses potentially. So let's start with the fun stuff. Bullish exits to take profits. Okay. This is a management technique for profitable trades. And we're using this term target. What does a target mean? Well, target is just a price level above the entry price. So we're in. It's a price level at which the trader plans to exit with profits if profits have been achieved. Okay. Target is not always accomplished, but it is, you know, like let's say a trader has a plan. Okay. I'm buying at 40 and I'm going to sell at 50. If they've said in their minds that they're going to sell at 50, that becomes their quote unquote target. And then it's up to price to see whether we get there or not. Now, this is commonly identified using previous resistance. So sometimes price has just been up to a level before in the past. So let's say we have a stock hypothetically, it's been bouncing back and forth between $40 support and $50 resistance. And we're buying in at support at $40. Well, maybe we're just using that previous resistance as that target. If there is no previous resistance, the trader might do what's gauge what they call a measured move. So what is a measured move? Well, let's say that this stock, we'll just use our example on our screen here. Let's say it's been moving back and forth between, and this isn't $40 and $50. I'm using round numbers for example purposes. But let's say our support down here is at 40 bucks. And it's been going up to 50, it's a $10 range. And then it breaks out of the $50 level. Where might a target be there if we're up in this now uncharted territory? Uh-oh. Well, maybe what we might do is just measure the distance of previous moves and use that measured move to gauge where it might go on the next move, even though it's up in this new territory, okay? So we commonly identify using the previous resistance as target or the measured move above the previous range, okay? And these approaches for managing profitable exits can be conceptually applied to both bounce and breakout entries. Okay, let's go back to our charts and look at examples here. So, you know, I think I'm just going to stick with the same chart, just for simplicity's sake, and maybe potentially in the interest of time. But let's suppose that our trader is okay with the fact that Visa appears to be breaking out on lower volume. So they're going to take that trade. But they're, look at this. We're up in sort of no man's land. We've never been here before, at least not on this one-year chart. First thing that a trader might do is go to a longer-term chart. Let's go to a three-year chart and see if there's anything historically that's been previously resistance. I don't see it. Okay. So what might we do here? We're in unexplored territory. Well, in this case, the trader might just look at the depth of the previous channel. So in this case, it looks like the most recent depth, 233 up to about 256. Let's just call that a $20 range, okay? Just for simplicity's sake. It looks like we have about a $20 channel, and we've broken out of that channel. The trader might assume, well, if shareholders of Visa were previously trading within a $20 range at a lower level, maybe they'll trade within a $20 range at this new higher level. So tacking on maybe conceptually again, $20 to this breakout point, looks like that's right around 256 or 257. That might establish a target, a planned exit of about 276 or 277. Okay. Now, a nifty way that this might be done when we've drawn a channel here, and I did, but let me do something here. I'm gonna delete my drawing. Right click on it. Let's just remove that drawing. Let's come down here and use our channel tool. If you didn't see that, I just switched my active tool to the channel tool. Now let's redraw our channel. There's our potential support. Resistance looked like it was about here. There we go. What we can do now is just right click on that channel and duplicate it. And you'll see what that does. It creates an identical, perfectly parallel set of lines. And I'm going to go up and attach that to the high end of our channel. Do you see that right there? I just overlaid it, basically copied it, stuck it up there like this. Okay. So, well, if you happen to see that on your screen, anyway, now we can just grab our chart and drag it down. And yeah, it looks like that's giving us a projected channel target, a measured move up around. I was rounding off to 276, 277 because I was using $20. It's actually more like a $23 channel. So it's projecting up to around 280 for a price target. So that is within, that's a breakout target within an uptrend. Well, what about maybe a sideways target? Well, in a sideways channel, we may just look at a bounce, maybe taking us up to a previous high. And let's see, what do we want to use? I mean, that's a fair example for establishing a target. For a breakout, maybe use the measured move. For a bounce, low to high. That's simply relying on previous resistance to establish our new target. Okay. Well, what about bearish examples? Before we move to bearish, let's talk about planning the other side of the trade. We had the fun stuff, taking profits. What about if a trade just goes sour? That's always a possibility, right? We see our breakout, we see our bounce, we take our entry, we're planning to move to a target, and the stock price just doesn't cooperate, and it moves down and hits, or it starts to sort of invalidate the reason for entry. So in this case, we're planning for the trades. This is a management technique for unprofitable trades. And this is typically a price level below our entry at which the trader plans to exit with losses if reached. Losses are really a part of trading. Yep, normal part of trading. Now, a stop is a type of sell order. It's the level at which we plan to just take losses. Stop the bleeding, stop the bus. I want to get out of this thing. Okay, so a stop in the case of a bullish entry is commonly placed below a previous support. In the case of a bounce entry, so the support level was the reason for the entry, or it's placed below the broken resistance in the case of a breakout. So that was also the reason for entry. So if our reason for entry becomes invalidated by price activity after entry, maybe that's time to get back out. Okay, now, always with stops, we just have to remind ourselves that stop is a type of order, and it's not a guarantee that we'll sell at a specific price. Okay, but here on an example, let's say we had a bullish breakout, breaking above a resistance level. That was the reason for entry. Well, That doesn't mean that price is absolutely going higher. The trader may plan, if price starts to go lower again, we're just going to pull the plug on this trade. What we thought was going to happen didn't happen. So does that mean that we place our stop right at our breakout point or right at our support level? Or do we give it a little bit of wiggle room? Now, quite commonly, the trader will give it a dollar or two or three, a percentage point or two or three, going below resistance on a breakout, going below support on a bounce. Okay? Ken? Yep, we could set up. I'm not going to get too much into different order types that we could use here. Today's the focus is on technical analysis rather than order placement. But a good question there, Ken. He's asking about setting OCO orders or using something known as a trailing stop. We'll use that in upcoming webcasts. All right. So what are some examples for stop placement for bullish entries? Well, let's go back to our chart. And let's say that our trader saw on Visa, we're moving up, breaking out through our price ceiling. We think that price is going to head on up here to $280. Oh, that looks pretty nice if it does. But what if the stock just reverses course and starts going down again? Well, in this case, it looks like our breakout level is about 257. Maybe we go a percentage point or two. That would be $2.50, $5 below our breakout. Maybe it's a few dollars below. You can see how going just dollars is going to be different. A dollar or two on a $10 stock is a very different stop level versus a dollar or two on a $260 stock like we're looking at today. So in our example here, the trader might look at, let's zoom in a little bit more closely. And actually, let me do one other thing first. Let me reset since I did kind of squeeze up our chart. Let's zoom back out here. There we go. Let's zoom in. Here's our reason for entry. If we break down below this, the trader might be patient. Well, we've been down here before and we rose. Maybe they set their stop, who knows, conceptually, down below that breakout point. Okay. Now, Speak Truth is saying, hey, isn't there a different way we can do this? Yep. Another great discussion that we'll be having in the future is different ways to place stops, including, yep, even using what's known as an average true range. Now, I'm not going to do that today, but good suggestion there, Speak Truth. But the bottom line concept here is if the reason for entry is invalidated by price action, that might be time to pull the plug on the trade. We have a sell order waiting for us down there. So that's on a breakout. In the case of a bounce, let's say we were taking an entry down here, off this support, we're starting to rise off that level. Where might the trader place their sell order there? Well, they might look down here below this support range, maybe not exactly in this case about $231. They might even look to recent lows and go below those. Have a sell order down there just in case price sells off. Okay. So, The bottom line lesson here is it's fun to plan for things going well, but we also might want to have a plan in case all of our hard work doesn't actually pay off and price just does what price does and it goes where it wants to. Okay. Now, what about our bearish trades? Well, very similar concept. We were just reverse that or we mirror that logic. A bearish exit. When planning for taking profits, this is a management technique for profitable trades, establishing a target. Target is a price level below our bearish entry, at which the trader plans to exit with profits if achieved. It's commonly identified using previous support. So if we're getting in at resistance, we might just be targeting previous support. Or we might use that same measured move technique that we used in our bullish example on Visa. And with this, as with bullish entries, these can conceptually be used with both bounce and breakout entries on our bearish trades. So for examples, let's go back here, look at a couple of our bearish stocks, RTX. In this case, we had our bearish bounce up at previous resistance. In this case, what the trader might be doing is looking to previous support to plan for a target exit. You might be looking to get out at or around $78 with whatever bearish trade they have in place. We could also look at our BMY example. This was our breakout. Okay. Here I've drawn a channel. I showed you that that function that's available on Thinkorswim. If I right click on this channel and duplicate it, I can grab that new now duplicate channel and just drag it down. And let's overlay that on our previous channel. So old support becoming new resistance. And here's our breakout. Where might the trader be planning a target exit? Well, in this case, looked like we were channeling 56 and a half down to about 51 and a half. That's about a $5 range, maybe another $5 range. So breaking out here might project down to here as our target. In this case, in this historical example, did a pretty fair job of reaching that target. So a measured move on a breakout, pretty common technique. Now, we might have also looked for a previous support level. There just aren't any examples of that on this chart. Okay. All right. So that is the plan for maybe taking profits on a bearish entry. Doesn't always work, though. How do we plan our exits on a bearish entry? This is a management technique for the unprofitable trades. And this is the price level above the entry at which the trader plans to exit with their losses if those are achieved. Now, a stop on a bearish entry is commonly placed above the previous resistance on a bounce entry or above the broken support on a breakout entry. And of course, as with our bullish stops, bearish stops are not a guarantee of a specific execution at a specific price, okay? So let's look at some examples here. Let's suppose that our trader had entered on this breakout right there. Let's zoom in again. Entered on our breakout, our entry level, the signal was basically as we broke through that level. So in this case, had price reversed higher, might be time to pull the plug on that. We might have a stop, an exit planned to cut losses, to take losses if we rise up through that resistance, okay? And in the case of RTX, if we're bouncing at this resistance here, and our reason for entry is that momentum is starting to carry us lower, and that momentum reverses and starts to head higher, now we might want to have a line drawn in the sand above that resistance. And it might be a few dollars, it might be a few percentage points. It is really up to the trader's preference there. But the logic here is that we were in for a certain reason. That reason and apparently is no longer valid on this chart. Time to pull the plug. Okay. Guys, we've actually, with that, accomplished everything that we set out to do today. We've talked all through entries and exits for bullish and bearish chart signals. We've discussed the application of those bullish and bearish entry and exit signals using current examples. Now might be the time to go get some repetition with these concepts on your own. If you haven't done this sort of support to resistance, bullish to bearish trading with targets and stops, might be time to go to your paper money account and walk through some charts. You can use historical examples to get lots of repetition quickly, but maybe make some decisions regarding new example paper money trades. Plan a target, plan a stop, and see how that pans out for you. I think that'll be interesting. Everybody, thank you for giving me your time today. If you enjoy these webcasts, make sure that you have subscribed to our Trader Talks webcast from Schwab Coaching YouTube channel. It's a great place to find the upcoming webcast. It's a great place to find the archives for the previous webcast. We have almost 200 archives out there already on a whole range of topics. So make sure you're subscribed to that channel. And also do follow James and me on X. That's the best place to connect with us in between webcasts. You can find James on X at James Boyd CS. My handle here is at Cameron May CS. Just track me down on X. Click that follow button. And that really is, again, as I mentioned, the best way to connect with me between the webcasts. It's a great resource. It's where you can get James's thoughts and my thoughts on new market developments between webcasts. It's also, if you reply to one of my posts, I try to reply right back to you and allows for more personal interaction than is always available, when the webcasts aren't live. All right, everybody, thanks for giving me your time today. I'm going to set you loose. I will see you again next Tuesday, same time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. I have other webcasts Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. I'd love to see you in those. I'll look for you on X, but hey, until that moment arrives when I see you again, I want to wish you the very best of luck. Happy investing. Bye-bye.